Assalamu alaikum everyone. How are you guys? So we are here with our very first lecture of the COVID-19 season 2, or you can say the wave 2 in Pakistan. So we are having this class of human resource management in the middle of the semester. And we are covering the chapter number 8, training and development and training human resource management. So this chapter talks about training. So there are lots of things that we need to discuss today. In fact, we have been discussing this lecture in our previous class, and we left this class in the mid as the classes were dismissed or suspended, and we have to transfer our teaching mode from face-to-face to online. So here we are, so let's start. I will be starting the same lecture as I have to complete the entire chapter for you all from the very first beginning slide. So let's start. So as most of you know, what is training and what is development? Training is a short-term activity, whereas development is a long-term activity. However, we will be more specific about training. So what is training is, we had discussed the same thing as the definition goes, that we actually here develop our human resources or develop their capabilities to achieve organizational goals and objectives. It's a process of acquiring different capabilities, or it is a process of developing their capabilities. When we are actually talking about capabilities, we are talking about their knowledge, skills, and abilities. So trainings can be both hard skill and can be a soft skill. What do you mean by hard skill or soft skill? Okay, mostly we say hard skill are those activities whereby a person who is engaged in a training or a person who is engaged in activity physically, whereas the soft skill trainings are those skills or those trainings in which we only share our information with one person to another person. Okay, there has been a commonly saying that if you train employees poorly, they will certainly perform their work, but the quality of their work won't be that good. So there's a possibility they will make costly mistakes. So poorly trained employees may perform poorly and make costly mistakes. Certainly it's true. Okay, so there are, sorry, I forgot to go on the full slideshow. So here we are once again. So there are different types of trainings that we have to conduct in our organizations. Basically, the book tells us that there are four different types of trainings. One are the required or regular trainings. Another is a job or technical training. Third one is the interpersonal problem solving skills. And the fourth one are the developmental career training skills. Okay. So what do you mean by required or regular trainings? These are the normal day-to-day trainings that every employee has to go through. Doesn't matter if you are a new or old, you have to go through these trainings time and again, just to ensure that you abide by all these rules and regulations, such as the safety and compliance. If you are working in any kind of production facility, or you are working in a factory or warehouse where you have to abide by certain safety compliances, or certain provisions are there, or articles are there, depends what type of nature or what nature of the business is. Driving provisions, if you have a facility that is so much huge where you can drive, so you have to go through those trainings. Okay, if you are having a company that is a manufacturing facility or production facility, there you have to tell your lower employees, your subordinates, the lower cadre employees, that is your, when I'm saying lower cadre employees, that means I'm talking about the normal labor, that is the plumber, electricians, supervisors, security guards, gardeners, and etc., etc. You have to tell them about their wage and our rules, how they are going to be charged, or how they are going to be paid, how they can earn overtime and whatever the case is. Okay, normal employee orientation, benefit enrollment, sexual harassment, prevention. These are the normal trainings that every employee has to go through. These are the required regular. They mostly occur again and again in the organization between quarterly or semi-annually, they has to occur. Doesn't matter if you're senior or junior. Okay, then moving towards our second type of the training, that is job or technical skills. Okay, here you are supposed to be given your job or technical job related trainings. Say for instance, if you are related with the customer service, you would be given training to the customer service. Say for instance, if you are dealing with the customers face to face, or if you are dealing with the customer on the telephone, if you are a call center agent, then you would be serving customers through telecom. Therefore, you have to be given certain customer service. Okay, what about your equipment operations? Say for instance, if I am a lecturer, the technical training for me right now in this COVID-19 would be how to use these technical gadgets that we are using nowadays, or how we can use the Zoom activity, how we can record these videos, how we can upload it on YouTube, and how we can share with our students. These are the equipment and operations activity type of trainings. Okay, record keeping needs, accounting, basic accounting, telecommunication, IT systems, and production details. So these are the minor example of technical or job related trainings. Coming towards our third type of the training, it is interpersonal and problem solving, whereby an employee is trained in various interpersonal skills. Say for instance, here we have been given certain examples of interpersonal skills or problem solving skills. Okay, communication skills. Most of the time employees are trained how to be more persuasive, how to be more effective when you are communicating, not only verbal communication, but also non-verbal communication. Okay, writing skills, how you can draft letters and all these things. Okay, how you can maintain good team management relationships, coaching skills. If you are a senior supervisor level person, so you must be having certain coaching skills. You should have leadership skills as well. However, leadership skills lies in our fourth category training. But however, you have to go through them. Okay, problem analysis and conflict management or conflict resolution, stress management. These are the certain types of interpersonal skills. Okay, moving towards the fourth category of the training, that is development and career. Business trends, strategic thinking, leadership, change management, career planning, and performance management. All these types of training are specifically given to the people who are in the middle of their career, and we are at the moment considering them for the future. We are actually working on their succession planning. We are thinking that these people would acquire or have place in the management roles in future. Okay, there are certain legal criteria and issues that you have to go through. Okay, the legal issues and training design and delivery. First of all, you have to develop a criteria and practice used to select individuals. So how you are going to select the candidates for a specific training. You need to conduct a TNA. What is TNA? Training need analysis. We will be talking about it later in this class. Okay, the second point is accommodation of individuals with disabilities. You have to ensure equal employment opportunity as well as. Here, we are not only talking about employment, we are also talking about equality. You have to ensure that you accommodate most of the special persons in the training, because they are also serving the organization, therefore they deserve to be trained as well. Okay, third point is requiring signing the training contracts. Okay, certain types of organizations require training contracts. Wise, if you are going to learn, if you are going to have this training, you will have to ensure that you, after returning from the training, you will give trainings to others. Organizational strategy and training. Okay, what are the basic benefits of the training? So here are the basic things that and the strategic human resource department can have from strategic trainings. Okay, the very first thing that the book says, the HR and trainer partners with operating managers to solve problems and make contributions to the organizational results. what we are going to do here, mostly when HR department undertakes any training activity, first of all, it goes for the knowledge management. The basic concept here is knowledge management. We try to find out where are the talented employees in our organization. Then we design a customized training based on the request of the operating managers to solve the problems. And we try to achieve organizational problems as well as minimize the cost of trainings if we go and outsource a certain type of training, or we send our employees to outside organization for certain trainings. Managers are less likely to think that training alone can solve the performance problems. Yes, this is a mentality, especially in Pakistan. We considered training as a normal picnic type of a thing. When our employees go to the training, they think that they are going to have some fun time in the training. The learning is the secondary preference, whereas the enjoyment is the first priority when we go for the training. Okay, moving forward, training effects on competitiveness, certainly wherever you are, if you are given training, it will give a competitive edge to you and to your organization. Training helps retain valued employees. Yes, if you would be given training, certainly you will be obliged, you would consider yourself before leaving the organization, whether you are giving same type of incentives, same types of benefits of training in that organization in which you are switching. Therefore, before leaving organization, you will certainly consider all the perks and privileges that your current organization is giving in terms of your career development, because training aids in your career development. So you become valued employee. When we invest in you, when the organization invests in its employees, the employees consider themselves as valued employees. Therefore, before leaving, they have to think of this thing, okay, whether the other organization in which they are switching is actually helping them or not, or giving them such type of benefits or not. Training helps accomplish organizational strategies. Obviously, at the end of the day, we have to achieve organizational goals with certain strategic management. Linking strategies and trainings. Okay, what do you mean by linking strategies and trainings? Okay, mostly what we have to do, what top managers do, they develop only strategies. They propose certain change, but how that change is going to take place, it is the basic middle manager or human resource managers who actually has to go and implement those strategies with the help of human resource managers. Therefore, we have the HR's job is, human resource manager's job is to link the strategies with the training activities to ensure that those strategies are implemented properly and desired outcomes are achieved. So here we have certain examples. We have four different types of the strategies, and we are in the second bar, we are looking that we have, So necessary outcomes to implement the strategies. What if we are going to implement, what will happen if we are going to implement these strategies, and what would be the outcome of these strategies, and how these strategies will be implemented, what kind of trainings they will be given. I will be explaining only one example for you. So here, the very first example, the increasing sale. That was a simple order, an implicit and explicit statement that says increase the sales. And how you are going to increase the sales, the top managers mostly pass on orders. So this strategy is just an order, but how we are going to increase the sale. So necessary outcomes to implement the strategy, identify the key sales elements and train the sales force. You need to identify the basic areas where your employees or where your sales force need to be trained, in which areas they are lacking, what are their weak areas, or how we can sale our product, how we can promote our product to the customer, how we should tell our customer about the features of our product. So what we are going to do in training activity, performance consulting, training design, we are going to talk about training. We have to consult with the trainers as well as with the field force. We have to identify which areas they are demanding and how we can develop them so that they can easily pursue the customers. Okay, moving forward, organizational competitiveness in training. Okay, a couple of minutes earlier, I was discussing about knowledge management. Here we are. What do we mean by knowledge management? Basically, it has to do with the management of the talented employees. Hereby, what we actually do, we identify talented employees, where they are sitting, in which department they are serving, and how much competency they are having in a certain area, how much expert they are. And then we leverage their competence. We leverage that intellectual capital that they have by training other employees in the same organizations. Say, for instance, Mr. Masroor is talented. He is an expert in human resource management. So we are going to leverage his expertise by training other employees of the organization without having much expenditure, without having much cost of the training. So Mr. Masroor will be given only 25,000 or 50,000 for one training, whereas if we had sent our employees to other organization, it might have cost them in most probably 400,000 or 500,000 rupees in Pakistan. Okay, gets the right knowledge to the right people in the right time so that it can be shared and put into the action. So knowledge management has to ensure that right knowledge should be given to the proper people who are actually working in a specific area. The another thing that we do in knowledge management or that we do in organization competitiveness and training, we actually leverage training for our revenue collection, our revenue making. We can use our expertise to train other organizations. Here I will be giving you an example of Sukkur IBA University, that we have this Department of Executive Development Center, where we actually leverage our faculty to train other organizations who's working inside the Sukkur city. We have different people coming from different organizations. We have the employees coming from Lou, that is the Continental Biscuits. We have employees from Alpers, Friesland Compina. Okay, we have these employees, we actually train them. We have employees from Sarso, Sindh Urban Rural Society, organization, whatever the organization is. So we train all their employees and charge them a certain amount. We train the State Bank of Pakistan employees on various different topics. We train the employees of the National Accountability Bureau of Pakistan at our Executive Development Center. So we actually earn money by leveraging our intellectual, our training resources. Okay, what do you mean by performance consultation? I was talking about performance consultation when I was thinking about linking the strategies with the training. So here we are. What do you mean by performance consultation approach? Okay, here you have to do three things in order to perform performance consulting. Okay, very first thing is to focusing on identifying and addressing the root causes of performance problem. You have to identify what are the problems that are creating issues for you. We are not achieving our full capacity. What is the basic root cause? Then the second point is documenting and comparing high performers with technical performers. You have to ensure that you have to compare high performers with the technical performers, document their results, and see in which area, which employee is better than A or B. Compare two employees A and B and see in which areas they both are good or in which areas they both are bad. Okay, recognize the interaction of individuals and organizational factors. when you will be focusing all these four things, you are actually performing what a performance consultation approach. Okay, so we have training of the global strategies. Okay, when an employee or when an organization expands its operations to other countries, this organizations need to go through certain cultural shocks or cross-cultural trainings are necessary in that specific area in order to ensure the success of the business of expanding to overseas. So here what we are going to do, we have to focus on three basic things. We have to give our employees the cognitive knowledge, emotional knowledge, and behavioral management, how you can use their emotions, how you can use emotional intelligence, and what is necessary, things that need to be understood before going to another country or before interacting with another culture. Because it is always said, what is right for one nation may not be right for another nation. Or one country says, if one thing is good, it is not necessary that it will be good for another country. Okay, I will be more specific. If liquor or if wine is legally sold in your country or used or consumed by normal people in the city, it is sold at the normal shelves in your country. If it is normal for you, doesn't matter. But when it comes to Pakistan, it is not normal. Therefore, we say, no, it's not legal to sell wine on normal shelves in departmental stores. So let's focus, let's be more specific about what do you mean by cognitive and possible trainings. What would be the possible trainings? Okay, when we are talking about intercultural competency trainings, we are actually, when we say cognitive, developing employees cognitively, so we are saying, you have to train your employees about cultural specific. You have to tell your employees about the traditions, history, cultural customs. You have to give language training to your employees because your employees are going to another country. They should be well versed in understanding and talking or having communication skills in that country easily. Okay. When we are talking about emotional component of intercultural competency training, so we are actually talking about cultural shock. You have to understand, you have to go through three phases. The very first thing, if you are feeling uneasiness in another country, certainly you are going through certain social shocks or cultural shocks. Therefore, the necessary trainings that is more important for an employee going to another country is social training skills, focusing on new and unclear intercultural situations. It is necessary that you should be given such type of trainings. Okay, what about prejudice? What about biases? Okay, what about ethnocentrism? When we are talking about ethnocentrism, we have this ethnicity problem. So some cultures consider themselves as superior as compared to other cultures. So you have to coaching may be clarifying. You need to coach your employees what to say, what not to say. There are certain other elements that are sensitive. You cannot talk about those things. The very best thing or important thing is you must be an active listener. Listen first and then reply. Verbal and non-verbal clues must be read properly. You should learn to empathize the other person who is talking with you. These are the basic trainings that need to be understood. Behavioral trainings, cultural assimilative methods are necessary. How you can assimilate in another culture, how you can make friends with another culture. These are the behavioral trainings. These are the social networking or PR skills, how you can generate your PR. International projects. Okay, it is necessary that before sending your employee to another country, you should ensure that this employee who is going to be sent to another country has the exposure of international projects. Social skill training focuses on intercultural situations are necessary. okay, developing a strategy, strategic planning, a strategic training plan, the basic things that need to be understood or learned before going for any strategic plan or training development plan, you have to ask following questions. Is there really a need for training to the employees? If there is no need, why to waste money? We are here. You need to remember one thing in your mind. The very basic function of the HR is to optimize the utilization of resources. You have to minimize the expenditure. You have to bring the efficiency in your expenditures. Therefore, ensure whether there is any need of training or not. If there is not, try to find out what is the problem. Then ensure who is going to be trained and who is going to deliver the training or who is going to conduct the training. What form of the training will it take? Will it be a training, a soft skill training or a hard skill training? What kind of training you are going to actually conduct? How will the knowledge be transferred to the job? Okay, once your employees are trained, you have conducted the training, how you are going evaluate your employees, whether they have learned it or not, whether they are actually using that knowledge or not when they are doing their jobs. How will the training be evaluated? You have to ensure, you have to mechanize the system. You have to develop and design a system in which you are going to evaluate your employees. Okay, I will be stopping here. This is the second part of the lecture whereby I will be talking about how you can conduct an employee orientation when a new employee comes into your organization. So the first video or the first part of today's lecture ends here. We shall be starting from this slide in our second video. Thank you. This is all for now.